I'm Steve Dergarabedian, and I run Black Walnut Studio. In this short little video, I'm going to go over some of the more difficult steps when it comes to making your own portable bench. One of the things we're going to cover is how to turn a perfectly round dowel into a threaded rod, and then we'll even tap some holes that'll let us clamp pieces and move the vise back and forth. Now, a portable bench is a great little tool, even if you have a full-size bench. One of my students has put legs on his and has raised it over his main bench so he can work at a more comfortable height. In fact, this one was made a little bit shorter so that it fits in my suitcase, and that way I can still woodwork and teach when I'm traveling. The bench dog holes on this are 3/4 inch, and that lets us use most of the Veritas bench accessories. And at the end, I'll show you how to make your own using the bench anchor and a flathead screw. Now, there are going to be some notes that you can download that will have the cut list, as well as some of the other points that we don't cover. So, let's get started. One of the first steps in starting this project is marking up your work so that we know what's the left, the right, the front, the back, the top, and the bottom. So, what we're going to do is we'll mark the 3 main pieces. We'll bring these together and put a cabinet maker's triangle across all 3. Now, these 2 are going to get glued to each other, and this one will have the space to allow us to clamp things along here. As far as the side pieces, we'll bring those together and draw the cabinet maker's triangle across those as well. And then we've got 2 spacers. One is just going to act as a clamping spacer and it won't actually get glued in. And this one is going to get glued in and a lag screw bolted through it. So we'll mark this with the triangle as well. And finally, the vise, we'll mark that, and that's going to go in here. Now this pin card is actually going to capture the threaded rod in the vise block, and that will allow it to go back and forth. In one of the upcoming steps, we're going to cut tenons on both sides of this vise block, and those are going to ride in 1/2 inch wide, 3/8 inch deep grooves set into the front piece and the rear piece. Now, we need to stop that groove in the front about 8 1/4 inches, which is roughly about here. We want that stopped because we're going to drive a lag screw right through the middle here, and we also don't want it to show up over here. The one in the back is roughly 7 1/4, 7 1/2. In reality, it can be much longer because the middle piece will hide it. I find it easiest to cut that groove at the router table, and just so that there's no confusion, I put an extra line where that cut needs to be made. We want to make sure that these 2 grooves are centered across both pieces. And just in case there is some discrepancy as to where the exact center is, we'll do this cut in 2 steps, ensuring that if we are off, that they're both going to be off by the same amount and from the top or the bottom. So to cut this groove in the front piece, we're going to make sure that the triangle is facing us and we'll run it into the bit. As far as this back piece, what we'll do is, again, making sure the triangle is facing us, and we'll start over here and run it to the left. Now that the grooves are cut in the front and the back, we can glue the middle piece to the back piece. Now I like to do a dry rehearsal, a dry run, just so I know that I have enough clamps, and also to make sure that they're sized properly. That way I'm not fiddling with them as the after the glue is applied. As far as glue, I like to use something like Tight Bond's white glue because it dries translucent. It leaves no visible glue line. Now that the glue is curing on the metal and the back piece, we can turn our attention to the joinery at the front of the bench. It's a bridle joint that we're going to pin later on with a 3/8 dowel. Now the tenon part of the bridle joint we do on the end pieces, that way it hides that vise groove from being seen from the side. Now a bridle joint can be done a number of different ways. You can do it with hand saws and chisels, all by hand. If you have a tenoning jig, it can be done on the table saw with that. It can be done on the bandsaw. It can also be done on a crosscut sled, which is typically how I do it. I clamp the front piece vertically and take a bunch of cuts, getting that part of the bridle joint done. And then I take the end pieces and I set up a stop block and nibble away to make sure that those two pieces come together. Make sure you test this fit often. That way you're going to get a nice and tight joint. Use the method that you have the tools for and that you are comfortable with. Next, we're going to mark and drill these 7/8 holes, which we're going to come back and tap. That allows us to clamp in this section right here. This is the be-all threading kit that comes with everything you need, including the tap, and I'll show you the dowel threading in a short little while. But this will allow you to cut the threads in the holes. I like to put a bit of wax, and I mean just a slight bit of wax, on the teeth. If you put too much, it'll end up clogging. And this 7/8 bushing will drop right into that 7/8 hole. And now you can start tapping this hole. You want to go at a slow and steady pace. And when you feel a lot of resistance, back it up maybe a half or a full turn, and then keep pushing ahead until you bore all the way through. We can now assemble the left side of the bench. This side is held together with glue and 3 number 8 by 2 inch wood screws. Temporarily clamp the spacer blocks in relative position and mark your positions where those screws are going to go. Using the same technique that we used on the end pieces to create the tenons, we'll do the same thing with the vise block taking it from this to that. Dry clamp your spacer block in position and test fit your vise block in the grooves. You want to make sure that it slides really well. Dry assemble the right-hand side of the bench and then find the center between where the vise block slides. Bring this mark to the front and find the center along its height. We're going to drill this with a 7/8 hole and thread it so that we can drive the vise block back and forth. While it's in position, mark for two screws. One of the more accurate ways of marking things is if you can do it referentially. And what I mean by that is, here's the 7/8 drill bit or Forstner bit that we use to drill the hole in the right-hand side end piece. So that fits perfectly in that hole right now, and we need to mark where that transfers over to the vise block so everything is in line. So what we can do is we can push the vise block against the right side end, and then using the point on the Forstner bit, we can make that mark, and now I have the exact point where that center of that hole is transferred into the vise block. Now that I have that dimple, I'm going to use a 3/4 inch Forstner bit to drill 1 1/8 inch down into that vise block. If you take a look at a completed bench, the underside, you can see on the bottom of the vise block there is a groove cut, and that's where this pin card is slotted into. Now that slot is 1/4 inch in from the end, it's 1/4 inch wide, 2 inches across, and 1.5 inches deep. We'll do that on the router table. Now that we have that groove put in, we need to be able to fit this pin card into that slot. So to round over the ends of the pin card, we can do that a number of ways. We can come in with a file and do that. I find it's easier just to come in with a block plane and just carefully round it over. Just make sure that you do a lot of test fitting. Once you've got it fitting nicely, let's mark that as well with a carpenter's triangle. We're going to use the same technique of marking our pin card referentially. So this was a 3/4 inch diameter hole. Got the 3/4 inch Forstner bit. I'm going to make sure that the pin card is fully seated, and now I'm going to mark where the center is. Now I'm going to go to the drill press and drill that out with a 1/2 inch Forstner bit and then come back and cut some slots. Using a square, I've continued the edges of that 1/2 inch hole down to the bottom of that pin card. So here's my cabinet maker's triangle, and I'm going to cut this section right out. So now that we have that slot created, I'm going to put the pin card into that slot, and you can kind of see what's going on there. If I push this down, that part of the pin card is actually going to capture a groove that we're going to put on the threaded rod. I'm not going to go into too much detail about the Be-All kit. There's lots of videos online that you can watch. You can even go to the Be-All Tool Company and see the demonstration videos there. But this is the first part of what we were doing. We tapped the holes. The second part is creating threaded rods. Now, this started off as a 3 foot, 1 inch cherry dowel. I've cut it down because it's a lot easier to do this when it's shorter. You can keep the threads, you can cut the threads much better when these are shorter. We're going to remove the threads and turn this down to about 3/4 of an inch. We're going to do the same on this end for about 3/4 of an inch by 3/4 of an inch. It could be a bit longer, that's fine. Those ends, we're going to do that on three of them so that they fit in our handle holes. We'll epoxy those in later. But what's going to happen is that pin card drops into this section right here. And that's what holds, or sorry, that's what moves the vise block back and forth. So because these threads have a pointy end, one thing else I like to do while it's, especially while it's still on the lathe, is to sand them flat at these tips. So this threaded rod here is going to be split in two, and it'll become the front clamping knobs at the front of the vise that will let you clamp things vertically. So in order to do this, what we'll do is we'll remove about 1.5 inches of threads right in the middle, and then we'll cut that in half. The next part of the process is driving the lag screw through the front, the spacer block, and into the middle of the bench. So I found the center, transferred that down to the front. This is a 5/16 by 3.5 inch lag screw, and the washer is about 7/8 of an inch. So we'll use a 1 inch Forstner bit to start the hole. This will allow the washer and the head to be inset from the front. We'll create a clearance hole through the spacer, and then finally a pilot hole so that it can grab the middle part of the bench. So the next step is to actually lock the vise block to the threaded rod with the pin card. Now, we're going to glue this in position, but I don't want any glue to get in here and lock it in. That would not be good. So what I'm going to do is I'm really going to pack it with a bunch of wax, and that way, if some glue does get down in there, it's not going to stop this from rotating. Now we can even put a little bit of wax on the slotted part of the pin card. So we're getting really close to the end here. We've only got a few steps left. One of the first things we're going to do is mark and drill the dog holes in the middle piece here, and also one here in the vise block. That's going to be in line with the center of this middle piece. A couple other holes we're going to drill is at the front of the bench, and those are going to be to lock the bridle joint so it doesn't come apart even if the glue fails. And then finally, we're just going to knock off the ears here on both sides and then do any leveling that we have to do for sections that aren't quite flat. You can do that with a jack plane, a jointer, or even a sander. So this bench is pretty much ready to go. Just a bit more cleanup, maybe a bit more flattening, and it's ready to be used. So I like to use 3/4-inch bench dog holes because I can use a lot of the accessories I have already for my Veritas bench. And that includes stuff like the wedge lock blade, which just drops in, and then you can lock that with the Allen key. Now, one of my favorite is this bench anchor from Veritas. And what you can do with that, again, it's a wedge lock. You can drop it in just below the surface and then lock that in with the Allen key as well. Now, you can get a 1/2-inch flathead bolt, make your own bench dog, and then you just thread that in. And by making it rectangular, I can use it that way, or I can use it this way, depending on what I'm going to hold. So you can use this portable bench much like you can a larger bench. If you're cutting dovetails, you can clamp your pieces vertically and do all your sawing. And that holds really well. I'm able to lift this bench. Something you might want to consider is putting leather or cork on the front of these threaded rods, as well as maybe in the vise block section. Making a portable bench is a great little project. If nothing else, you're going to end up with a work surface that you can use in conjunction with your main workbench in the backyard or anywhere you want to travel and do a bit of work. There are some difficult parts to this project, but if you take it step by step, I think they can easily be accomplished. Hopefully, I've shown you some steps that are intriguing to you, and it's going to make you want to try this project for yourself.